get started. Welcome back to physics, folks. Hope to continue colloquium today. It'll be by Ben Sikes, who is an associate professor at the University of Kansas in two departments, ecology and evolutionary biology, and the Kansas Biological Survey. Ben did his PhD at the University of Guelph, Ontario, and he was a postdoc at Austin, Texas, and in New Zealand. And he has an A-positive blood type, if transfusions are needed. He just told me that. We're not going to be able to call. Anyway, here we are. The title is something about
fungi. Sure. Yeah.
Why fungi are fascinating.
Yeah.
Ben Sikes.
We'll see if I can convince you. Thanks. Is there anything more intimate than knowing someone's blood type? There is. I have four kids, so yeah, I guess you're right. So I'm a biologist at a physics colloquium. I'm going to do my best to convince you that biology can be seen through physicists' eyes, and I hope that you can look at the things that I do and break those down and take them apart and think of them that way. And the first thing I'd like to do just as an exercise is to do that together. So this is a really cool video that I show sometimes, and as you guys watch it, I want you to think biology, but also just think physics, okay? So let's see if it's loud enough. Let's see if it works even at all. Well, the music's not on, but the music's so good. Do you hear it almost? Didn't make it. Yeah, so I show that to just undergraduates, but I show it all the time to myself and to my kids just because it's so mesmerizing to think of all the diversity in the natural world. But hopefully you guys see elements of motion, of gravity, of light, right? Biology wrapped around physics, right? That's essentially what life is. And I also kind of like it, not for some of these videos that popped up, but because it stars fungi through a lot of that. And that's what I want to talk about today, is the drivers and consequences of what I call fungal community ecology. And I'm going to try and define a little bit of what that is. Let's see if this guy works. Maybe not. All right, so just today I'm first going to show why I think fungi are effective models to understand community ecology, which I'll define in a second. We're going to take a little deep dive, a vignette, into how we have done that with fire ecology and thinking about how fire impacts these communities and their functions. And then I'm just going to talk briefly about some really cool ongoing explorations we do with broader sets of microbes and what they mean, what we can do with them. So first, just to convince you that they're interesting, if you're not familiar, the word ecology gets thrown around a lot. Here's a few different definitions of ecology. Essentially, at its roots, ecology is the understanding of the interactions between organisms and their environment and organisms and one another. And things that pop up over and over are that we're worried about the distribution and the abundance of organisms and about interactions between organisms. So those are the things within biology that we're thinking about when I'm referring to ecology over and over again. Does that make sense? Ecology spans a huge range of different levels of organization, everything from the individual organism and its physiology, how it operates, all the way up to how biogeochemistry and organisms work to create the global biological processes. We often, my lab inhabits this world, but we span up from communities, which are interactions among populations of different species, up to the ecosystem level, and even all the way down to the single organism level. Obviously, when we work with microbes, which I'll tell you about in a minute, they're often associated with single organisms. So at the same time, you can work at multiple levels. You can work on lots of different organisms interacting, but they live on a single organism and infect it, or affect how it acts. So the fundamental questions in my discipline are very simple. What are the factors that structure ecological communities? So out in a desert, you can imagine there are pretty strong abiotic factors, right? Temperature, precipitation, these are the things that structure communities. It gets more complicated than that, though, because as you go to other ecosystems, you have those abiotic factors. Here's a rocky intertidal community made classic by this guy named Payne out on the West Coast. And he was able to show that these starfish, for example, structure the entire community as keystone predators. So it's not just the physical environment, but the interactions with organisms. And increasingly, we play a strong role in structuring communities in natural ecosystems. So we want to understand what we're doing to those communities' composition, right? Who cares how much they just are influenced? We want to know what the consequences of that are. So these communities have functions, and what we want to know is what the consequences of those community shifts are. So this is a remnant tall grass prairie from around here. Here's what it looked like, probably around here, maybe 300 years ago. We've done tillage agriculture for about 200 years, and if we just leave places alone, we don't get back the same function that we had before. That's one of the things we explore, is how those community shifts have consequences. There's also invasive species. Sometimes they're helpful. This bird is not native, but it distributes berries for species in Hawaii. These zebra mussels love and destroy this mussel to death. They're hugging it to death. But they also are really great at processing nutrients in water. And ultimately, we have to think about what are the consequences we're interested in. We often measure basic things like how much biomass is produced, or how much water is filtered, or things like that, right? But we could have huge changes in communities with very little changes in their function. We could have huge changes in function with very little changes in communities, or we could see relationships between them. These are the fundamental questions in community ecology, and I got interested in exploring them in the below ground ecosystems. So the soil ecosystem is really cool, I promise. You can go in your backyard and you can discover things that nobody has named or even knows what they do. So a single teaspoon of soil can hold upwards of millions of different organisms, thousands of different species, and we know almost none of them. We don't have names for them. We have no idea what they do in natural history. So if you read books like about Alfred Russel Wallace or random people traipsing the globe, discovering things, the soil ecosystem is called the poor man's tropical rainforest for a reason. You can find lots of new things. So it's also fertile for discovery. If you have to think about where fungi live in this world, this is a simplified tree of life. Here's bacteria. Here's archaea. This is the vast majority of life. For those of us who don't know, we are the star. Yay. Fungi are here. They are actually our closest relatives. Fungi are more related to us than they are to plants, despite their traditional study within botany departments. This is an idea that was thought about to estimate the total amount of carbon in our biosphere. So if you could see all the way down here, this is the gigatons of carbon. Plants are most of it. Here's fungi. They're a respectable 12 gigatons. Animals are only about 2 gigatons here. And if you're really interested, all of us, nearly 8 billion humans, are still only 0.06 gigatons of carbon. Those are like big questions that I ask myself sometimes, right? Like, does humans breathing affect global climate change? Right? These like random questions that you don't think that there's answers to. Anyways, I just thought this was an interesting one. It's like, how much do all humans weigh in carbon? Fungi are an important portion, third only to plants and bacteria. They also represent that hidden diversity really well. So this is just a bunch of pictorial images of the really cool diversity of things that they do and how they look. The cool thing is that we estimate there's between 3 and 5 million different species, but we've only ever identified about 2% in all of human history. So imagine that there's, so this is a kingdom, right? So imagine among all animals, there's 100,000 of them. We would have only ever identified, that means name and pointed at, 2,000 of them, right? So really, you can throw a rock and name a new fungal species or find out something new that it does. So it just embodies that act of discovery. So just to pull in what fungal community ecology is now, what are the things that shape fungal communities, and what are the consequences of changes in those communities? That's what I'm going to talk about today. Yeah, interrupt.
This is stupid, but could you define a fungus?
Yes, absolutely. Can I? Good question. It's a massive kingdom. So it's a set of organisms that most of their body extends via hyphae. So they grow, not like us, they don't just get bigger, although not that big. They just grow out and branch. There are some that form yeasts. They are heterotrophs, so they can't make their own food, just like us. They have to get food from other things that they eat. What else do you want to know? Yeah. Is that it?
Body spread out like
a... Yes, so this is an example of one. I should have brought more show and tells. This is one from outside. Schnikes. You guys got a lot of booby traps around here. I just pulled this off of the ash tree outside. This is one example of one. You're covered in some too. You probably have some in your cup. It's okay. There's yeast everywhere. There's all kinds of things floating around the air, like molds and mildews. We have them, not just in Malat, even in the brand new buildings. But they form fundamental roles in our ecosystem. We're going to talk about those in a second. But mostly for these, for example, you can see the hyphae that are going through them, and they are eating the wood. And so that's their heterotrophy. Instead of thinking about eating something and putting it in your body and then excreting things, they just exude chemicals in the environment, digest things, and then absorb it back through their hyphae. Yeah? Did you have a question? Yeah. Yeah, good question. That's a really great question. So what we do basically is we go out and we look, and we time how long we look, and then we keep looking, and then we time how long we look then, and we basically make these curves that says if we kept looking on it ad infinitum, we would estimate there's about this many things. So it's called a rarefaction curve, but basically it's a wild guess based on the fact that we have a rate at which we discover new things when we look. But then we have new technologies that break out and they inevitably screw up that estimate. I'm not sure that's a good answer. Like, that's the answer, but that's not a good answer. How about that? So why do we give a shit about, why do we care about fungi? Just like this guy, they're the major consumers of dead material. We wouldn't see much recycling without them, so they're vital in food webs to release nutrition. In fact, as I was telling John, this is a relative of a fungus that evolved probably about 350 million years ago. About 400 million years ago, a mutation led to plants evolving lignin. So that's the stuff that makes trees hard and holds them up. But nothing could eat lignin. And so because of that, oxygen concentrations on our planet soared, a lot of biomass built up. That's what we harvest coal from now, are those things. That was called the Carboniferous period. But about 50 million years after that, a fungus had a mutation that allowed it to break down lignin. And that's what they diversified, and they started eating all this food that nobody else could. And this is a long relative of that, right? So people don't actually understand that basically what we're doing when we're burning coal is we're burning really, really, really old trees that things couldn't eat at the time. Right? So, decomposers, fundamental roles. It's about to be Halloween. I found a picture of a moldy pumpkin. A lot of people don't know that they're actually important predators and pathogens. This has some amazing physics. These are hyphae of a fungus. It has specialized lassos to trap nematodes. They swim into it, and as soon as they do, yeah, absolutely.
Sorry, this might be like a really dumb question.
There's no dumb questions. Go.
Get rid of all the lightning, which like would bring down the oxygen content of Earth. What would have happened if that mutation never happened?
Well, we wouldn't be here.
Really?
Well, I mean, dragonflies at the time were about as big as we are. There were giant spiders and all kinds of giant things because of the oxygen level that was going on. A lot of people actually thought that fires were really common too in that time because there were such high oxygen levels. So I don't know. We don't really have, maybe we were arguing about multiverse theory. Maybe there's a multiverse or something where that never happened. But and I don't know how that, we don't really actually understand the evolution of that, of how that just that mutation just popped in. But you can imagine this massive resource that nothing could eat just sitting around, right? So there was opportunity. So these lassos, when it weaves its way through, will just blow up like a balloon and trap it. And then we were talking about them being heterotrophs. They basically exude enzymes into the body of the nematode. And as it jellifies, they suck it back into their body. It's pretty nasty. But there's awesome YouTube videos of it. Check it out. They can also cause diseases on us. We don't often see them, but in immunocompromised patients, hospital-acquired immune fungal pneumonia, for example, is a really bad disease that a lot of people can get in hospitals. And because fungi are so closely related to us, we don't have a lot of medicines to attack them. Bacteria and prokaryotes actually are kind of different enough that we can make good medicines. Fungal medicines are trickier. But the way that most people understand the damage that fungal diseases cause is through their effects on crops. We lose billions of dollars a year. That's just the economic impact. Those crops could feed people, right? So we care about what fungi do to crops. They are the single biggest crop problem, crop pest, is fungi. We also now understand that fungi perform intimate interactions that are necessary for all of our systems. So that's what this word mutualist means, or mutualism. That's two organisms that interact with each other and both get a net positive benefit. The origin of the word symbiosis was the definition for lichens, which we first thought were plants, but now we understand are a mutualism between a fungus that wraps around an algal cell. And even the past 3 years, we've discovered actually that almost all of them are hyper levels of multiple kinds of fungi all partying together. So instead of thinking of this as a single organism, now we know it as a suite of organisms, just like we are. Okay?
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely. Ask away.
Do the organisms that make up lichens also exist independently of the lichen, or do they only exist?
That's a really great question. So lichens are a broad, diverse group. The algae inside them are not that diverse, and it seems like the algae are almost always only found with the lichens, but some of the lichens can exist without the algae. You have to think about what's being exchanged too, which is really important for this next step. These are mycorrhizal fungi, if you ever heard that word. The vast majority of plants on their roots in the ground, they have fungi that live on their roots. And they can't live, many of them, without these fungi. And what they do is they trade the carbon that they make from photosynthesis with the fungus, and the fungus gives them nutrients from the soil as well as other kinds of benefits. So it's kind of a fundamental thing that they do to benefit plants on the planet. Almost all of our crop species are heavily dependent on fungi that live on their roots. All of our trees are. Okay? Are you guys still being able to see this through physics eyes? So every now and again, yeah.
Which came first then, the fungus?
Excellent. Yeah, that's a classic joke in mycorrhizal ecology. So we have fossil evidence that these guys were there when plants colonized land. We have structures that look just like them. So I don't know what that means, but they're old. They're as old as land plants. So maybe they were doing something funky in the water. So I think hopefully this convinces you that most of the time we care about plants, and fungi are directly and indirectly modifying the base of the terrestrial food chain, right? Plants. That's what they're doing. They're directly influencing the energy flow at the base of terrestrial food webs. So they do it through things like mycorrhizal fungi, which, as we said, help through this nutrient majigger. We have pathogens, which are just nasty sometimes, but who knows what they do. And then we have the indirect effect of decomposers that are breaking down nutrients, making them available again for plants. So I'm just going to take you through a couple of quick things that we've done to think about community ecology theory, because I think they're interesting from a physics perspective. So the first one is thinking about something called assembly history. We have a pool of species, and these are all local pools. Let's make it even more simple. This is a regional pool of species. It contains species A and species B. There's local pools that get populated by those things, and they have A and B. And if you have extinction that happens in one of those local pools, it can be recolonized And essentially what assembly theory works with is the fact that depending on the order and the timing of arrival, you can get different consequences for what the community is. So here you can have a community that only consists of A, and B can never go in because A went in first. Right? So there's rules, essentially, priority effect rules. And in fact, that gets even more cool and complicated in that you can think about two base things. These are plants, A and B. You don't have to know what they are. There will be no test. These are C and D that eat A and B. And if you put them in one order, 1, 2, 3, 4, you get one community. And if you change that order, you still put them all in to all the jars, but you just change the order, you get a different community that forms. In this case, D and B, let's see, C and D, so you get both of the consumers, but only one of the producers. Yeah?
This is one of the things you can't describe in classical distribution.
That's true.
You need a density matrix.
That's right.
You should have been here last week.
Okay. Did anyone build a time machine? Yeah?
So are these stable configurations? So at some point later, if you inject one back in, will there be a chance of being able to come back because of...
Yeah, that's a great question. So there's a whole field that mathematically explores that. It's very difficult to do experimentally, but we do it sometimes with microbes like this. But we have transient states, and we have alternative stable states and things like that that we think about equilibrium states and things like that. And in fact, that's a really important context for things like ecological restoration, where you have different alternatives.
I was thinking if you cut down all the trees in the area and trees come back.
Yeah. So yeah, we think about that all the time. Okay. Yep. This is just a simplification of that. We did explore that with co-assembly of both fungi and plants at the same time. Just like I showed you for those guys, let's mix them together in different orders. They all go in every system, but we change the order that they went in. And the interesting thing is that when we culture those fungi and we grab seeds from different plants, that the order in which we put them in, both fungi and plants mattered. And in these little experimental communities, ultimately what we saw is that the timing of both affects the diversity of the plant community, but also whether or not the invasive species, the one we don't want in these kind of systems that was planted, whether or not it dominates or it's actually minimized, just based on the timing in which we put them in. So we have a historical contingency to all the communities out in nature. We looked into why that might be. Is it the traits of the actual fungi, or is it the environments where they live? This one has lots of nutrients. This one has a little. We did this with a high school student and an honor student. And essentially what we do is we put them together on a plate, and we let them fight each other, kind of like Pokemon, except we change the environment that they fight each other in to make them high or low nutrients. And then we scan them and see who wins. And ultimately what we saw is that the fast growth was a trait of the organisms and not simply decided by the environment in which they lived. Right?
What do you do with the fungi?
What do we do with them after?
No. You were talking about doing that to the students.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, the context of that, I'll work on that phrasing. No students were harmed in the making of that publication. I did a postdoc in New Zealand, like John said. That was really a huge data set that they had of over 120 years of the number of agricultural pathogens and non-native pathogens that had come to New Zealand. And what they're trying to figure out is, why do they come here, how fast are they coming here, and can we do anything about it? Has anyone ever been to New Zealand? No? Ish? Okay, if you've been to New Zealand, what are the airports like in New Zealand? Yeah, they have high biosecurity measures. So New Zealand has a huge endemic flora and fauna, and they care about it. And so we were trying to estimate whether or not the simple increase in economics, we were just using some Bayesian models to look at whether or not this was related to the rate at which fungal pathogens were coming in. They're important agriculturally and for native species. Essentially what we found is that there's a break back in the 70s between the rate of increase in trade and the rate at which new pathogens are coming in. That could have been caused because we just ran out of pathogens globally, like they were starting to get enough, a sampling effect. But actually that's not what we saw. Instead what it was is because they had instituted specific kinds of practices like seed certification schemes. And the way we knew that is that it was working in some areas in industries, but not in others. So things like seed crops, the accumulation rate had leveled off. But for other things like forestry, it was still accelerating faster than the rate of trade. Yeah?
So what's the rate that you get new fungus just from evolution, whatever?
Oh, like mutation?
Yeah.
Ooh, that's totally heterogeneous across the kingdom, right? It's a massive kingdom. So in some areas, they pop up quickly, and in other areas, rather slowly. Depends on selection, right? So remember that it's like saying, how fast do you get new animals, right? You get probably like new amoeba pretty quickly, but or I guess that's a protist. You get new like bugs quickly, but you might get new, vertebrates slowly. Maybe. All of these things that I talked about, though, focus on those two issues. That wasn't a very good answer, though, eh? What was the impetus for you asking how fast do we just get new ones?
Well, you were talking about things globally, like leveling out.
Mm-hmm.
And so, ideally, I mean, if you have enough air travel, then you won't have new funguses coming into your country or whatever. But like, if things are mutating pretty quickly, then you'd always have new stuff.
Yeah, so I think in this case, because we're not using genetic techniques for, like, we don't have that data for 120 years, we would be calling a fish a fish. Like, if it looked like the same-ish thing, it might be a new species or whatever. But what we didn't find any relationship between all of those things that they make you do in New Zealand. When they start instituting those practices, it didn't change the rate of accumulation at all. So even though they make us do all those, that's not helping. Or it's not affecting it, at least. That wasn't appreciated by the New Zealand biosecurity people. All right, so I'm just going to talk about fire for a minute because I think fire's cool. It's also a window, I think, into how we do all of those bigger picture things that I've just laid out for you so that you can understand kind of the basis about it. And fire is a really cool feedback that happens here on Earth, but it's also a really strong selective pressure that I think is applicable to other kinds of things that humans do, and maybe even some things that we want microbial communities to do potentially out in like space and on other planets and things like that. So a lot of natural disturbances, like what's a good natural disturbance? Lightning. What's another good natural disturbance?
Tornadoes.
Right? Unlike most of those, fire actually can be controlled by internal mechanisms. So fire has to burn things, and the rate at which those things build up can control the probability of fire. That's unlike a tornado or a hurricane, right? Even though we can have global climate processes, it's not like Puerto Rico is doing anything to make hurricanes happen more often to themselves, perhaps, right? I don't think. So even though these ecosystems look really, really similar, they're brown and gray and dreary, like it will be soon here. Sorry. This one actually has a different type of fuel. It's filled with needles of pines and pine cones, and those burn in a very different way than the litter underneath this forest that's more like what we see here. And we know that those kinds of fuels have big impacts on fires. Fires shape the plant community. The plants that survive that fire make fuels that make fire more likely. It's a cool positive feedback. So this graph, all you need to know, this is the how long things got hot for and how hot they got. This is adding no pine needles or adding 50 grams of pine. And no matter how much you added of the other species, you always see the bump if you added any pine needles at all. Okay, so what the composition of the fuels is matters more than just how much of them is there. You can imagine the same thing if you tried to make like a campfire and you kept stacking on like stuffed animals, right? Versus stacking up something that burns less well than stuffed animals. Regular animals. That's a good one. Not non-mobile animals. Right. I'm submitting a care report on you. Soil biota have strong effects on the fuels as well. As we talked about, fungi and bacteria are the dominant things that eat fuels. Fire kills them and alters the environment in which they live. And soil biota, like we talked about with the mutualisms, are critical to making the fuels. So I'm just going to put together a series of statements that we can argue about, but these things lead to the experiment that we did. First, we know that fungi from a lot of experiments are more susceptible to fire than bacteria. Bacteria are like, fire. fungi are like, oh my God, fire. Except that matters who you are. There's some fungi that are hyper-dramatic and die easily, and others that are more like bacteria, and even some that are like fire, like AC/DC, right? These guys are stimulated by fire. In fact, there's whole itinerant groups of people that follow around the Forest Service in the western U.S. as they burn just to collect morel mushrooms, which pop up often after fires. As we already learned, fungi directly alter litter, that, i.e. the fuels that fires need, and they indirectly alter the production of litter. This is just a graph that says that from a Nature paper, trust me. Or we can argue. So we're just honing in again on the idea that we set out at the biggest picture, how does fire shape fungal communities, and what are the consequences of those effects? Critically, whether or not there might be feedbacks, like we see for plants. So here's our conceptual model. Here's a fungal community of dots. Fire comes, only some survive. Yes? Of the ones that survive, some of them are adapted to the post-fire environment that's created. It often looks like this, black and nasty, but full of nutrients. And of those that are adapted, they can modify the fuels indirectly through their effects on plants and directly by eating the fuels in different ways. Yes?
When you say they, by their effects on plants, do you mean that the fungi that survive are the ones that have the most common symbiosis with the trees that produce fuels, or that they're actively affecting in some way trees to produce more fuels?
You're asking like an internal question. I'm just saying very broadly that by how fire affects fungi, they might differentially affect some of the ones that could make plants produce more fuels or produce less fuels even, right? Okay. But yes, I think that that's, we're trying to explore that with some of our work, yeah. Like maybe the ones that are in symbioses are less affected or something, but then maybe have consequences for the production, yep. I think, yeah. Ultimately what we want to know is this a feedback loop, right? Do they make more fuels and then that feeds back to fires and then you have a self-sustaining system, okay? So the first question we asked was just that, are particular fungi adapted to recurrent fire, looking at the fungal community shifts and trying to link it with differences in soils. That's what this word means, soil factors. I should just use that word, jargon, sorry. So we went down to the border between Florida and Georgia. This entire area used to be covered by this massive forest, the southeastern coastal plain that burned all the time. Did you guys know that? I didn't know that. And I'm from like right up here, like in Tennessee. Anyways, it burns all the time now. The Wade Tract is the best example of old growth, longleaf pine forest in the world. And this is it before it burns, this is it burning, and this is about a month after it burns. So it's actually pretty crazy. Let's see if we can make this majigger work. It's pretty crazy how fast it comes back. And hopefully you can see visually, via the things that we can see, just how quickly this happens. This is the Moody Preserve, which is pretty close to the Wade Tract. There's nice cool music for this one. So these are prescribed fires that are sweeping through. And this is like a week after there. So we see this massive diversity of life that's adapted to fire, but we know almost nothing about the microbes and their role in these systems, whether or not they're adapted and then whether or not they might have functional consequences.
Well, I have a question then.
Yeah?
I understand that the reason that trees take over grasslands is because trees survive fire, and grasslands die. So if you wait, trees always win. Or they tend to.
If you don't burn. Yeah, where we are here.
Okay, so now, given that, is there a particular relation between trees and the fungus?
There are. That's a really good question. Yeah, and so I don't know about from the fire aspect, we haven't studied that, but in the southern hemisphere, for example, pines have been introduced, And wildling pines, believe it or not, they're called wildling pines. All the pines that you see in the Lord of the Rings movies are not native to the Southern Hemisphere. And they have a fungal wave below ground that goes out in front of them. And they can't establish unless that fungus is there. So you'll see them actually as waves moving across the landscape in the Southern Hemisphere.
They need the fungus.
They have to have the fungus to do their thing.
They all need a fungus.
The pines do, for sure, yeah.
And most of these trees.
Yep. Yep.
A commercial forestry in Georgia.
Yep. So they plant longleaf as well. Yep.
These continuous, the preserves and the commercial?
Yeah, that's a really great question. So we have a project on that's trying to look at how the communities look like in a preserve that's right next to the commercial industry. The commercial industry actually sometimes inoculates because they know their trees need the fungus, so they'll like spread an inoculum down if they don't think that it has enough. It probably has enough anyways, but how the density and diversity of the organisms that are there, the trees, the hosts, might shape those fungal communities is another really cool question. I'm not sure is that what you were thinking about?
Yeah. How much difference there is in the environment.
Yeah.
Versus
yeah, yeah, and whether or not that's all driven by the host, by the forest itself, or by other things is something we try and explore. Just like we did with the fighting, is it an intrinsic trait of the fungus, or is it something about the environment that makes them that way? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So this is what we explore with our fire feedback model. We've got a lot of data. We're just comparing something that just burned to something that hasn't burned in a while. To do that, we use something called next generation sequencing that was like, it's like 15 years old now. I don't know if you guys have the same problem, but when every time somebody names something next generation, then it immediately is replaced by something that's cooler. So we have third generation technologies and stuff like that now, but this is the most common used one. It uses what's called bridge amplification. You guys don't care about all this. It uses high-tech chemistry and PCR, if you heard that word before. And then we generate a ton of data, A's, G's, and T's from our sample, and we use high-performance computing to do bioinformatics, to sort out who's who, who's where, and we have all kinds of traits around the sample that they were collected from. So it's these giant big data sets that we get to play with. So after we digest all that information, we can sort them into what kind of taxa were there, and these are the kinds of questions we're interested in. So we have almost 5,300 things that are shared between burned and unburned sites, but we have 2,500 that are only ever in burned sites, and another 4,000 that are only ever in unburned sites. We can dig into that a little more. This is only a two-dimensional, apologies, John, ordination. I'm sure you guys do these kind of things, but if you don't, this is a non-metric, multidimensional scaling. All it means is that two points that are closer together means the communities from those samples were more similar to each other. Okay, the blue ones, the cold colors, are from unburned places. The red ones are from burned places. Everything above the dashed line was a sample we took from the litter right above the soil. And everything below the dashed line with the open circles is from the soil. So they sit on top of each other like this. Okay, so I think I'm not trying to give you a bunch of information. The bottom line is that you can see clear differences between blue and red, between burned and unburned, and that those differences are greater up in the litter than they are in the soil, which might be a little more insulated. Okay, yeah?
Are these places that burned or didn't burn naturally, or were they the same exact sample that you burned or you didn't burn?
So, exactly. They're not the same place. It's not a place that I took a sample and then a year later I burned it. Yes, absolutely, that's true. Yep. And we take into account a bunch of other multivariate things like nitrogen content in soil, but we do stratify when we create the experimental design so that we try and pick places that are more similar to each other with regards to canopy and all kinds of crap like that. So we see that there's a restriction. Over half of the fungi were either only there when fire had been there or were never there if fire had just been there. And really coolly, about 35% of them are these hyper-specialists. So you're only there in soil when there's been a fire and you're below a pine tree, right? Or you're only there when there's never been fire and you're in the litter only, and right? Like they're these hyper-specialists. But another quarter of them are hyper-generalists. So they're found in every kind of thing under the sun, like soil, litter, fire, no fire. Yes?
So where are these hyper-specialists when there aren't bird forests?
That's an excellent question. So what? I don't know. We don't know. Do they live below the ground? Do they come back? Are they riding the wind? Those are questions we're trying to answer now. Are they dispersing back in, or are they basically hiding and they're below our detection threshold? Are they down deep in the soil where we're not sampling and they're coming back up? We don't know.
They live in fire.
They could. They could be riding the winds of fire. Right. So that's communities change. Now the question is, do we care? Are there functional consequences? So this is the fuel modification portion. Again, let's just take it from the start, things that burned and things that didn't burn. We're looking at new litter that we collect out in the forest. We bring it in, we grind it up like a bug would when it chews it up and breaks it down. We gamma irradiate the litter to eliminate all microbes, but try not to change any of the nutrient features, or less so than like putting it in an autoclave. And then we put them back in these 30 micron mesh bags, so you can see the little hyphae, hopefully those little white things, maybe you can't see them, in the mesh. It only allows in microbes, that mesh. It doesn't allow bugs and stuff to crawl in. And then we throw these out, and then we bring them in over time. And the change in weight over time tells us something about how fast the fuels are breaking down. So this is just from the fire, burned and unburned sites, 3 months, 6 months, and 9 months. You can see, I think, with your eyes, without statistics, that the burned are lower than the unburned. After only about 3 months, we have about 40% greater decomposition of fuels in the unburned sites, they haven't burned in like 2 or 3 years, than the sites that just burned. Okay? So to say that a different way, if you just burned, the fuels there are not going to break down as fast as the place where fire hasn't been. Okay? And it's actually pretty strong. It continues the entire year after fire, and it didn't really matter what kind of litter was in there. We had some right below the pines and some far away. Really, the breakdown was whether or not it had just burned or not. We went in, so this is showing the differences in fuel modification that we hypothesized. We now wanted to hit them over and over again because we're sadists. So we burned the same plots 1, 2, or 3 times within a 3-year span. So here's some fire. We get to play with fire out in the field. A site could have burned and then burned again and then burned the last year, or maybe it didn't burn and then it didn't burn again, but then it finally got burned. It creates this differential short-term fire history, right? So you could burn every single year, you could burn none of the years, or you might have burned somewhere intermediate of that. Same thing with site-specific litter, grinding it up, sterilizing it in the bags, out in the field, pick them up over time. Okay? We also calculated something called the decomposition rate. I was told if I included an equation to physicists that that was exciting. This is as complex as, this is as complex as the equations got so far. Basically, you can imagine the decomposition rate as an exponential function that breaks
delta
down.
T,
okay, we'll work on that. Delta T. As you can imagine, this is a really complex process. We measure a lot of things. I've done some work in the past, and we did it again using structural equation modeling. Is that a common technique in physics? Not really? Okay. So when we measure a shitload of stuff in ecology, we have to understand how they're related to one another. And so we basically use partial regression coefficients to try and understand causal pathways between variables. So this is essentially a barf-ready structural equation model path analysis from the system. The red lines are negative correlations. The black lines are positive ones. The green things are things about the system out in the world, like pine needles. There's not going to be a test. The yellow ones are things about the fire. The blue one is a nutrient. Here's the fire regime we imposed. And here's the breakdowns over time from that decomposition rate. So it's a cool technique that allows us to untangle complex systems, but maybe not as well as some of the other techniques you guys use. The take-homes are that when we increase the frequency of fire, we get even slower decomposition. Surprise! The maximum temperature of the soil and litter have direct impacts on decomposition. We can follow that pathway through, and it's a very strong correlation. And the more frequent fires reduce ammonium in the soil. Higher ammonia means higher decomposition. So we see slower decomposition because lower ammonia. So we can trace these multiple pathways by which this is actually happening through the use of path analysis. So we saw majority of fungi are fire adapted. Fire slows microbial decomposition. More fire slows it more. The key takeaway is that in this system, we also see evidence that changes that fire causes to the fungal communities results in changes in the breakdown of fuels, and that should create a positive feedback loop, just like we had seen with the plant communities. But nobody had studied this in the microbial system. So, to zoom back out, that's exploring how fire is shaping these fungal communities and what the consequences are. We're now playing with that in greenhouses. We set up these ginormous greenhouse experiments where we stick a little bit of a fungus in a thing and stick a little bit of a plant in a thing, and then we see what happens. We measure them over time. So in this case, we're looking at different fire severities instead of different times. That's exploring that indirect feedback loop through plants. So we can't really do that in the field because microbes are hard to manipulate in the field. They're just everywhere. They're not easy to manipulate in the forest. So anybody that ever does a fire talk to you guys' group, if they don't put at least one short video of a fire tornado, they're not a real fire ecologist. So there's a huge number of fires in Western North America. Oh, it froze. Oh, wait, you kind of saw it, didn't you? Should we watch it again? So we're trying to understand why these wildfires are breaking out. Maybe integrating microbes into that predictive model can help us to explain why there's buildup or breakdown of fuels. If you have a fire out west, you might think, we got hit by a fire, we're good for a while, right? But from the data we're showing from these systems that are getting hit over and over with fire, they actually have microbes that are helping to create a positive feedback to exacerbate that situation, right? So that changes some of the predictions of the models, right?
Firebugs.
Firebugs, right. Pyrophilic. We've got all kinds of funny words. Oh, there's Ed Young. That guy's fun. He talks about two worms and stuff. All right. If we zoom back out to look at some of the other projects we have, they're still focused on these big questions. To think about fungi and how their communities are structured and what the consequences are of them. So I'm just going to walk through quickly those. We're working with a group called the Land Institute that's based out in Salina. Their idea is to shift our agricultural system from planting plants year after year to planting plants that grow back year after year. That's called perennial agriculture. But there might be ecological consequences of that because the bugs in the soil might change, and that could have consequences for the sustainability of that system. This prairie was going to get destroyed by this, is about to be destroyed by this road widening. What we did is we went in with a giant tree spade and took giant chunks of it and then moved it into new locations and try to see whether or not it will spread or it will get eaten. If you can imagine taking a system from here on Earth, an intact system, and trying to put it on something that we had terraformed on Neptune, you might wonder whether or not it would establish and spread from there. That's kind of an implicit assumption that we have no evidence for it will do. So we're trying to work that on heavy biological systems here, what I call heavy biological systems, that already have a significant amount of inertia, and we can change the dosage by putting more of those intact systems together to see if we can overwhelm the outside system. Those are edges. The Rockies create a massive rain shadow. Did everybody know that? I'm not from Kansas. So we get like twice as much rain here as they do in western Kansas, and it creates this brilliant natural rainfall gradient. We're looking across that in an interaction with land use because we have native prairies and disturbance. This is all funded by a big EBSCOR project called the Microbiomes of Aquatic Plant and Soil Systems, MAPS. I got to drive a tractor. Also, we had this rig that would just take giant chunks out of the earth. Check this out. So it shoved itself down in the earth with a PVC, and then it kind of will pull it up, and then you can just take it with you, and you have like a chunk of whatever system, and it's like intact. And it's big. Like this one's only 10 inches, but we wound up doing them on a foot chunk. So that's kind of like the tree spade, right? You can take whole systems with you and experiment with them. We're also working on a cool project to think about how host phylogenetics, the relatedness among species, is linked with their microbiomes. This is the Philippines. There's a guy named Rafe Brown in the Biodiversity Institute in the museum, Natural History Museum. He studies all kinds of frogs over there and how being on different islands has led to their evolutionary radiation. What we want to know is if you think about the different kinds of information that you get to tell one species from another, what kind of things do we use? What kind of things do we use with birds?
Beaks.
Wings, right? Prey, all kinds of things like that. And then we got genetics, and we're like, oh yeah, that stuff's cool, but let's just look at their DNA. Right? Well, that's an independent, relatively independent line of evidence, right? That you can talk about whether or not they're related to one another. They're not independent. But now what we are asking is whether or not you can do the same thing with the microbiomes of the organism, because they act in many ways. They're the same kind of data as the genetics, but they're actually not the organism. They're the associated organisms, either in the stomach, like maybe we can tell your signature by what's the microbiome in your stomach, and that's different from you. Maybe that's because you have different diets, or maybe it's just because you have a different genetics, right? So we're exploring that, the microbiomes of these frogs on their skin and in their stomachs. But also that's important because they're affected by a fungus called chytrid, which has been decimating amphibian populations around the world. And then finally, we've been working with the Besson lab to try and play with space stuff. I think space is cool. We're not the first to do this, obviously. There's a whole astrobiology program that goes and hides in deep sea vents and goes down to Antarctica and tries to collect microbes that we can throw in space and see if they survive, right? There's whole offices of planetary protection at NASA to make sure we don't spread things around. But we make these massive culture collections every time we do experiments here on Earth to try and understand things like priority effects or fire ecology. We have all these things already. We actually do outreach all the time with kids where they just touch them and then see how gross they are. Or, you know, see how gross their water fountain is, or how much soap works, right? Like, touch a plate, wash your hands, touch a plate again. So the idea is whether or not we can go to those natural systems and pull a big library of microbes, and then we can start challenging them with space conditions. So this is the International Space Station. In 2014, I think, the Expose R module was put out there. They put a lot of little microbes out and exposed them to all of the rigors of space with different kinds of shielding. Some of you may know there's also microbes in space already that we didn't intentionally take there. This is the ISS. There's some actually growing on the outside of the ISS. One of them is Aspergillus niger, which can cause aspergillosis. It's a bad lung disease, but also is the main chemical production of citric acid. So if you're getting extra vitamin C in your orange juice, thank Aspergillus niger. My biology of fungi group did a project where they zapped this with increasing doses of radiation, and it grew faster and it gets darker. Mm-hmm. So we have organisms that know space, or at least are dealing. Yeah, go for it.
But I would assume, well, I don't know if this could be a wrong assumption, that inside, getting inside the space station, and the astronaut suits themselves all have filters that are too small for these to get through?
I would too.
I would hope so.
I would too. But I will tell you, as someone that runs a microbiology lab, it is nearly impossible to keep all of the contaminants out because we are the biggest source of them. Like, literally, when I walk in my clean lab, I just brought in, like, more microbes than I'd ever want to. We have HEPA filters and UV radiation to sterilize crap, right? But, so, I don't know. I don't know how much of it was us. It's not certain to me that they, like, floated off from Mars and landed on the outside of the ISS. Instead, but I don't know. Okay. So Dave's already done some work with balloons. I have a bunch of kids. He's got daughters, so we're trying to make it kid-friendly. We have a balloon launch that we've been planning that we're going to launch soon that has both biological components and physics components, because what the exposed modules often lacked was in-situ measurements of some of the environmental forces that are filtering the biological communities, like cosmic rays. We don't know what those measurements were at the time when the microbes were being killed or thriving. So Brendan has this awesome idea that we could use particular microbes to actually look as bioindicators for physics. I found this calorimeter. Is that how you say it? Calorimeter? That's the one. Online. There's a great one. So the question is whether or not, when we know microbes can bioluminesce, like we saw in the very first video, right? Whether or not we can find ones that could bioluminesce based on particular kinds of radiation that we might want. So, for example, this is from a lab that I worked in at Tennessee. They inserted this thing called a Lux gene, and right in front of it they could put something for insulin, and if you didn't have enough insulin or if you had too much, then it would light up in the chip. Maybe we can find organisms or even genetically engineer them that could light up for particular wavelengths of light or particular kinds of functions of physics that we want. That's me talking a lot. This is money, and these are people. I have questions if you do. Yes?
This is maybe a softball question, but I don't study physics or ecology.
Okay.
So sorry.
That's okay.
It's the best I can do. So you mentioned multiple times throughout your presentation that many of these aspects are not studied maybe as widely as they should be or could be.
Yeah.
I'm curious what your thoughts are on why that is. So for example, I work in local government. One of the biggest issues we have is that people don't think about the underground infrastructure, and I'm wondering if it's similar with the field of ecology. People just don't think about it because it's not right in your face.
Absolutely. I absolutely think that's true. It's a perspective thing. I mean, when we watched that video of the forest springing back after fire, the reason we knew it was springing back is because the plants sprung back and we can see them, right? We didn't have like a time lapse of what was going on in the soil. And even if we did, I'm not sure that would resonate nearly as much as the plants coming back. Oh my God, it's getting green, right? So yeah, I absolutely think that that's a bias that we have. That's just it's an anthropomorphic bias. Yeah.
So when people grow plants hydroponically, there's a soil network. There may be some kind of matrix they put the, I don't know if that's the word, they put the plants in to grow. But how do they, are they selecting plants that don't need fungal support? Or is the fungus growing in the water? Like how does that?
Yeah. So that's an excellent question. That's a whole field of research that's trying to study whether or not kinds of agriculture that we do, including hydroponics, are selecting for particular like dependencies that they may have had since like 500 million years ago that they don't have anymore. In the hydroponics, I think it's often bacteria that cluster around the roots. But remember, you're feeding, if they need nutrients from the fungus, and instead you're giving them all the nutrients they need from the water, maybe they're getting by without the partnership, right? Because they're in this kind of semi-non-normal state, right? We see the same thing out in the environment, actually. If we go into an agricultural system that depends on those fungi, like corn does, and you fertilize the crap out of it. All the fungi that are there, many of them will become parasitic because the plant doesn't need them anymore. So you just screwed up the stock exchange, right? You basically flooded the market with cheap nutrients, and now the people that were providing nutrients, the things that were providing nutrients, no longer can get what they need. So they're just sitting there like, I'm going to take your carbon, but they're giving nothing that the plant needs back.
So we're on the same branch as fungi.
Absolutely.
And the plants are, how big is the genome
of a fungus? They're widely variable. Remember, it's a whole kingdom, right? So there's things that have much, much smaller genomes than us, and there's one that's like 70 or 80 kilobases, what is it? Gigabases? Gigabases long. So like way, like 10 times as big as humans. So like there's a huge, you know, in all the things people have, I think this is the same question to you. Like they've internalized that fungi is a thing, right? This is, oh yeah, fungi, right? But remember, they're an entire kingdom that's like a billion years old. So they actually represent all these variable things, just as variable, in fact, more variable than all the kinds of plants.
So what makes them more like us than a bacteria?
So they're eukaryotic. So I'm sorry, more like us than a?
Than a bacteria.
Yep. So they're eukaryotes, just like we are. They have chitin, which is the same thing that crabs, that's their major structural feature, the same thing crabs and fingernails and things are made out of, right? Chitin. That's keratin. Chitin is the exoskeleton stuff. They share a ton of genes with us. So the genetics of what they do is very similar to us. They're a cool model system for that. Just if you look at the most recent common ancestor of three of us, or four of us kinds of things, we have shared a more common ancestor, a more recent common ancestor with fungi than they have shared, for example, with plants, or than we have shared with any other kind of organism.
So they have mitochondria then?
They do have mitochondria, yep. The yeasts are weird sometimes. Remember, there's always, I'm sure you guys always have an exception, right? Don't you guys always have those weirdos? Like, anybody else? Yeah?
So, regarding the fungus that thrives in the roots of plants, I'm wondering, for desertification, how much of that is driven by the fungus versus the tree population?
Oh, for deserts, for like increasing. So I think those are global processes, at least is what we think about those kind of things right now. That's kind of like the rain shadow, but on a global level, right? That's like the equator always gets lots and lots of sun, no matter what time of year it is. And in the same way that you have rainy areas and dry areas in the tropics, that's just a dry area that never gets its rainy season.
Right, like the spread of deserts and the worries like with deforestation.
Yeah. So there's a cool project, actually, you should check it out, right at the Sahel, right at the bottom of the Sahara, where they're planting all these trees to try and stop that. I'm not sure if anybody's done like fungal work or microbial work along that, but they've planted something ridiculous. I think it's like billions of trees to basically stop the southward march of the Sahara. So that would be a cool natural experiment where you could ask whether or not, you know, fungi are doing something to stop that spread. Yeah.
Talk. Thank you again.
Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for letting me talk to you guys.